Now, the greatest radio shows of all time.
Suspense.
The Shadow Node.
Washington calling David Harding, counter-spy.
Classic radio theater.
The Great Gildersleeve.
Fibber McGee and Molly.
Dragnet. Gunsmoke.
The Lone Ranger.
Now step back into our time machine with your host, Wyatt Cox.
Good evening, friends of the Inner Sanctum.
We head for the town of Springfield and check out what's going on in the Anderson household, an episode of Father Knows Best, as it was originally broadcast 71 years ago today, December 6, 1951, The Attic. And we thank you for tuning in on this Tuesday. This is the sixth day of December. It is the 340th day of the year, 25 days remaining till we get to 2021. Quick reminder, tomorrow, our Pearl Harbor tribute to the folks who gave their all. And when America was attacked on this date, on tomorrow, December 7th, 1941. On this date, December 6th, the first edition of the Encyclopedia Britannica published in 1768. In 1790, Congress moved from New York City to Philadelphia. 1849, American abolitionist Harriet Tubman escaped from slavery. 1865, the 13th Amendment to the Constitution ratified, banning slavery. 1877, the Washington Post published for the first time. In 1884, the Washington Monument completed. In 1897, London became the world's first city to host motorized taxi cabs. A presidential address broadcast on this date in 1923 on radio for the first time. President Coolidge spoke to a joint session of Congress. 1933, U.S. Federal Judge John M. Woolsey ruled James Joyce's novel Ulysses was not obscene. The day would become known as Woolseymas. Everglades National Park dedicated in Florida in 1947. In 1957, a launch explosion thwarted the first attempt to launch a satellite.
Reaction, I believe, is the normal reaction of every American. I'm disappointed.
The NASA reports and then Vice President Nixon on the launch pad explosion on this date in 1957, the U.S.'s first attempt to launch a satellite. In 1961, President Kennedy spoke to the National Association of Manufacturers in New York City.
I have not always considered the membership of the NAM as among my strongest supporters. I'm not sure you have all approached the new frontier with the greatest possible enthusiasm. I recognize that in the last campaign, most of the members of this luncheon group today supported my opponent, except for a very few who were under the impression that I was my father's son. But
the president went on to discuss increasing exports and balance of payments. 1973, the House voted 387 to 35 to confirm Gerald Ford as Vice President of the United States.
I, Gerald R. Ford, do solemnly swear.
I, Gerald R. Ford, do solemnly swear
that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
That I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
Against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
Against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same.
Gerald Ford replaced Spiro Agnew, who had resigned. He would, less than 8 months later, be sworn in again as president, becoming the first and only man to have served as both vice president and president without being elected to either office. It was on this date in 2006, NASA revealed photographs taken by Mars's global surveyor suggesting the presence of liquid water on Mars. And in 2017, President Trump's administration officially announced the recognition of Jerusalem as the capital of Israel. among those who left this mortal coil on this date, Burr Tillstrom, the puppeteer behind Kukla, Fran, and Ollie, singer Roy Orbison, Don Ameche, the fine actor, the president and commissioner of the National Football League, Pete Rozelle, Werner Klemper, we remember him from Hogan's Heroes, also wrestler and manager Jimmy Del Rey. Number of people born on this date who are no longer with us, they include poet Joyce Kilmer, also lyricist Ira Gershwin, the fine actress Agnes Moorehead. And what does it say that an actress who did so much wonderful radio drama is going to be remembered as a witch? And Dora in the television program Bewitched. Boxer James J. Braddock, born on this date. Bank robber Babyface Nelson. Fine pianist Dave Brubeck. Actor Wally Cox, no relation. And singer Bobby Vann. I have to tell you, I've seen a lot of Bobby Vann on game shows and hosting game shows. And on both sides, he was pretty good for what it was. Let's see. Don King, the boxing promoter, 92 years old today. From Poltergeist, The Big Chill, and The Day After, Joe Beth Williams, 74. Founder of Craigslist, Craig Newmark, 70. Comedian Stephen Wright. And I don't have any Stephen Wright recording because I don't want you to fall asleep. But some of the things that he said include, a lot of people are afraid of heights. Not me. I'm afraid of widths. I recently went to the hardware store and I bought some used paint. It was in the shape of the house. I also bought some batteries, but they weren't included, so I had to buy them again. In school, they told me practice makes perfect, and then they told me nobody's perfect. So then I stopped practicing. Stephen Wright, funny man, 67 years old today. From Northern Exposure and Friday Night Lights, Janine Turner, 60 years old. You remember Elian Gonzalez, the little boy who came with his mom to the U.S., but she died in making the crossing from Cuba, and then they insisted that he go back to Cuba. He is still alive at 29, and I believe, if the reports I've read are accurate, he's a dad, and he has a job, and he likes being in Cuba, so God love him. Elian Gonzalez, 29 today, and singer Tiffany Houghton, also 29 years old, though some of the people celebrating the 6th day of December as their birthday. If this is your birthday...
Hi, we're the Four Freshmen, and we just want to say... Happy birthday to you!
71 years ago, December 6, 1951, Robert Young, Father Knows Best, on this Tuesday, Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox, on your favorite radio station. Thanks for making us a part of your Tuesday here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Now an episode of Father Knows Best, The Attic Auction, from December 6, 1951, 71 years ago today.
Mother, is Maxwell House really the only coffee in the world?
Well, your father says so, and your father knows best.
Yes, it's Father Knows Best, transcribed in Hollywood, starring Robert Young as Father. A half-hour visit with your neighbors, the Andersons, brought to you by America's favorite coffee, Maxwell House. The coffee that's always good to the last drop. When it comes to definitions, you can't do much better than Webster, can you? So let's see what the old master had to say about the word den, D-E-N. Taking our trusty dictionary in hand, we find that a den is the lair of a wild beast. It is also, and again we quote, a quiet, snug, private retreat, as a room set apart for reading. Doesn't seem to be too much connection, does there? But a half hour spent with the Andersons in the white frame house on Maple Street will help us to understand that Mr. Webster knew exactly what he was talking about. Like this.
Stand still, Betty, please.
Mother, if you only knew how I hated this dress.
Nonsense. All it needs is a little touching up and it'll be as good as new.
But it'll still have shoulder straps.
Betty, if I hear one more word about that dress, you can't go to the dance at all.
But, Father, every other girl... jumping creepers.
Most ridiculous thing I've ever heard. A man comes into his own den to read a magazine and he can't even do that.
We'll be finished in a minute, Jim.
That's what you said an hour ago.
I know, but Betty, I can't do a thing if you're going to wiggle like that.
I'm sorry.
Dad,
I've started this article 8 times and I haven't gotten past the first sentence.
Is it a nice sentence?
It's... Kitten, why don't you go upstairs? That's a fine place to study.
It's lonesome.
Dad,
this is a big house. We've got a living room and a dining room and a breakfast room and a... Why does everybody have to congregate in the den?
Betty, you're moving again.
You're tickling me.
Dad.
Daddy!
Doesn't anybody ever listen to me?
Did you say something, dear?
I said... Honey, let's be fair. There's no need for everybody to be in this one small room, is there?
We'll be finished in a minute. How does that feel, Betty?
Okay, I guess.
Dad.
Daddy!
Margaret, this is supposed to be my den. I'm supposed to be able to relax in here quietly. But it's a sewing room and a study hall and a... Kathy, stop that.
What?
Those are pencil shavings. They don't belong in my pipe.
Oh.
Dad.
So help me if I don't... What is it, bud?
What?
What do you want?
Oh, what happened to the original capital of the United States?
Jack Benny's got it. Now, will you please let me read this article?
Jim, if the boy needs help...
Well, why does he have to ask me? He's got all his books right in front of him.
Daddy!
What is it, Kathleen?
Ask me what the Indians used asphalt for.
I don't care what the Indians used asphalt for.
Dear, it's part of her lesson.
All right. What did the Indians use asphalt for?
The Indians used asphalt to fix the roofs of their houses.
Fine. Now...
Ask me if the pioneers liked asphalt.
No.
Jim, really?
I'm going to finish this article if it's the last thing I ever do.
The pioneers did not like asphalt.
Kathy...
Because their horses would get stuck in the swamps.
Kathy...
And die.
That doesn't.
What does what?
Margaret, if it costs me $8 million, I'm going to do it.
Do what, dear?
Build an extra room.
All right, Betty. Turn. That's a good girl.
I'm getting so tired of this dress.
Margaret, didn't you hear me?
Yes, dear. You're going to build an extra room.
How could Jack Benny have the capital of the United States?
It says right here, turn your attic into an extra room. And that's just what I'm going to do.
There. Now how does it feel?
It feels fine.
I'll turn it into an extra room with a lock on it. That's what I'll do. And I'd like to see anybody come up there.
Come up where, dear?
To the attic.
What are you going to do in the attic?
Honey, this article I've been trying to read, it's got all the plans and specifications for turning an average-sized attic into 200 square feet of living space for less than half a cent a foot.
You mean it tells you all that in one sentence?
It was a very long sentence.
Oh!
You see this, honey? That used to be an attic.
Dad.
It cost this man in Milwaukee only $73.45. And look what he's got to show for it.
Dad.
Bud, not again.
But I have to ask you something.
Go ahead.
That thing about Jack Benny, that was a joke, wasn't it?
Yes, it was a joke, son.
That's what I figured.
Well, let's get going, Margaret.
Going? Where?
Up to the attic. We've got to get started on this, don't we?
You mean now? This very minute?
Naturally. When I make up my mind to do a thing, I do it.
But, Jim...
Come on, Bud. Put those books away. You too, Kathy.
Holy cow, Dad.
Jim, let's be sensible. You're not going to start building a room this very second, are you?
No, but I'm going to clear the decks. We're going to cart all that junk out of the attic so I can lay out my plans.
Oh, dear.
Father, you can't expect me to go up there.
Why not?
In an evening gown?
You'll be the best-dressed junk mover in town. Let's go.
I still think...
Honey, will you please trust me just this once? All right, Bud. Kathy?
This is gonna be fun, isn't it, Daddy?
Come along, Betty.
Jumping creepers.
What does he mean, junk? I didn't see any junk in the attic.
Jim, are you really serious about this attic business?
Of course I'm serious.
I don't know why it couldn't wait another day.
It's waited long enough, and so have I. After all, I do a lot of work at home, and I need a place where I can be alone to... figure out things.
You certainly can't call my stuff junk. It's practically invaluable.
All right, Bud, open the door.
Yes, sir.
Jim, I just thought of something. Where do we put the things we take out of the attic?
It's very simple, honey. Well, we'll find someplace.
I think it's going to be quite a problem.
It isn't going to be a problem at all. We'll just throw most of it away.
My pogo stick! So that's where it was.
Should have thrown it all away years ago. Look at it. Broken furniture, old boxes, pieces of... Where did that come from?
You mean the metal? That's valuable, Dad.
Did you cart all that junk up here?
It isn't junk. It's magnesium.
Look at this. A 3-foot pile of broken records.
They aren't all broken, Father.
They've got to go.
But they're collector's items.
Betty?
Some of them go as far back as 1946.
Get rid of them.
Jumping creepers.
Now, what's this? Broken toys. Dolls with their heads bashed in.
I don't have to get rid of them, do I, Daddy? Please?
We're going to get rid of everything.
My old toys from when I was young.
Jim.
Honey, you're as bad as they are.
But if the children feel...
Look at this old sewing machine. You were going to give it away 15 years ago.
I can't give it to anyone, Jim. It doesn't work.
Then why keep it?
Because it belonged to my mother. And she made my wedding dress on it.
But how about this high chair? What earthly reason can we have for a high chair?
We've had it a long time.
I know, but... Margaret, we can't afford to be sentimental.
Aren't there some things we can save?
Where?
Well,
we can probably find some place, Father.
The government saves things. Why shouldn't we?
Because we don't own places like Texas. All we own is one small house.
Downstairs, you said it was a big house.
It is a big house. It's a big house for some things, but it's small for other things.
How can it be big and small?
Kathy, I haven't the time to... Bud, you know what I mean, don't you?
Oh, sure.
Good, then you tell her.
Why?
I've got to drag out all these heavy boxes and things, so you explain it to her.
But why should I... Holy cow.
Well?
Go ahead, Bud.
Well, this is a big house for houses, but... Well, you see, a warehouse is bigger, but people don't live in warehouses. They live in houses that are smaller, and for houses that are smaller, ours is bigger. You see?
Sure. You don't understand it either.
I guess that takes care of that.
Isn't it amazing, Jim? I mean, the things that pile up.
That's what I've been telling you. You know, this is going to make a terrific office. I never realized how much space we had up here.
I'm still worried about where the children are putting everything.
Yes, sir. Box it in with some plyboard walls and it'll be quite a place. Well, let's go downstairs.
Jim, didn't you hear me? I said...
I know, honey. You're worried about where they're putting everything.
Well?
Frankly, I don't care, as long as it isn't up here.
Jim? Just a minute.
What?
What's this?
Oh, that. I thought we ought to save that.
Jim Anderson.
It's just that one thing, honey, and it's very valuable.
This monstrosity?
Now, wait a minute. That isn't a monstrosity. It's a genuine antique.
And naturally, an attic office is exactly the place for a genuine antique... hitching post.
Honey, I don't intend to use it as a hitching post.
That's a comfort.
But you certainly don't expect me to get rid of a thing like that.
Why not? We're getting rid of my mother's sewing machine.
But, Margaret, my great-grandfather got that hitching post right after the Civil War, and the man told him, I suppose Abraham Lincoln hitched his horse to your mother's sewing machine.
And I suppose your mother made wedding dresses on that silly-looking hitching post.
Margaret, you're losing your temper.
I'm not losing my temper. But if my mother's sewing machine goes, so does your grandfather's hitching post.
My great-grandfather.
Exactly.
Dad!
Father! Daddy, we did it!
Keeping a hitching post.
Just a second, honey. You did what?
We got it all in, Father!
We don't have to get rid of anything.
Wait a minute. What do you mean we don't have to get rid of anything?
We put everything in the garage.
So we don't have to throw anything away.
Not even one little thing.
There you are, Jim. You see?
You mean everything fit into the garage?
That's right, Dan.
Except one thing.
What was that?
The car.
Car doesn't need to be in the garage. December 6, 1951, Father Knows Best on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. The news from 71 years ago today is next. Thanks for tuning in to Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox on your favorite station. We're listening to an episode of Father Knows Best starring Robert Young, as it was originally broadcast Thursday, December 6, 1951. In the newspapers of that Thursday 71 years ago, these were some of the headlines. Communist truce delegates dodged or gave evasive answers on terms for supervising a Korean armistice, but the United Nations command indicated it was ready to probe today for areas of common ground. A third subcommittee session scheduled today at Panmunjom. In exploratory talks, the communists cited two Russian satellites, Poland and Czechoslovakia, as suitable to serve on the communists' proposed neutral inspection teams to police a Korean truce. The Reds also mentioned Switzerland, Denmark, and Sweden as qualified to serve because they had not sent troops to Korea. Charles Oliphant resigned as chief legal officer of the Internal Revenue Service yesterday, deploring vilification and piling another sensation on the heap already collected by a House investigating committee, as Oliphant gave up his $14,800 a year job in the Truman administration. Frank Nathan went before the inquiry group to deny a charge that he tried to shake down a wealthy Chicago lawyer for $500,000, with promises to fix his tax troubles through influential friends in Washington. When Nathan shouted that his accusation was a dirty, filthy lie. The conflict in testimony brought an announcement from Congressman King, the Democrat of California, chairman of the committee, that a transcript of the testimony about the alleged shakedown would be sent to the Department of Justice for perjury action. The government authorized manufacturers and processors to seek higher price ceilings on thousands of products, including coal, clothing, meat, milk, canned foods, cigarettes, liquor, drugs, and cosmetics. The Office of Price Stabilization issued an order bringing nearly all the nation's manufacturers, processors, mines, and oil firms under the Capehart Amendment to the controls law immediately. The amendment permits ceilings to reflect nearly all cost increases between the start of the Korean War and last July 26. District Attorney Griffin Hawkins testified yesterday. A newspaper man, one of five on trial for allegedly defaming 16 public officials and three gamblers, needled him in a newspaper column for nearly a year. Hawkins, one of the officials allegedly defamed during a law enforcement campaign conducted by the Lake Charles American Press, quoting, "I am at a total loss to understand why Mr. Kenneth L. Dixon would take advantage of his position as managing editor of the American Press to hurt me." Dixon is the first of the five newsmen on trial on defamation charges in this southwest Louisiana city of 50,000 population. Nobel and Pulitzer Prize-winning playwright Eugene O'Neill in critical condition at Faulkner Hospital in Boston. The 63-year-old dramatist, whose home is at Marblehead, returned to the hospital last weekend after several previous visits. He has Parkinson's disease, described as a deterioration of the nerve centers. Senator Robert A. Taft yesterday advocated an embargo to all new programs by the government except those related to defense. The Ohio Republican presidential aspirant made this declaration at a press conference just before Senator Harry F. Byrd, one of the leaders of Southern Democrat rebels, told a press conference that if President Truman is renominated, the Southern Democrats might just vote Republican. Byrd from Virginia blasted the Truman administration for socialism, irresponsible spending, and moral deterioration. The two senators spoke from the same platform in Los Angeles before the House of Delegates of the American Medical Association. And a Madison man returned from his vacation without any fish, but with this fish story for his friends. A fisherman named Fisher, living in a neighboring cottage, caught a fish. Fisher didn't like fish, so he gave the catch, a pike, to another neighbor named Pike. And though some of the day's top news stories is reported in the newspapers of Thursday, December 6, 1951, on your radio, Father Knows Best, the conclusion next on this Tuesday Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox on your favorite station. On Wednesday's Classic Radio Theater, an hour devoted to the broadcasts of December 7th, 1941, including a broadcast of H.V. Kaltenborn's news from that date and an address from the National Commander of the American Legion. We'll let you hear all of that tomorrow at this time on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Now, though, the conclusion of Father Knows Best, 71 years ago, December 6th, 1951.
By now we know all about dens, don't we? We know what they're for, how they're used, and how one beards a lion in his own. Den, that is. In this case, it's almost a full day later, and the lion, Jim Anderson by name, is on the phone. Like this.
That's right, we've piled the whole mess on the front lawn.
All right, there isn't any lawn, it's out on the front snow. Mr. Adams, I don't want you to buy this stuff. I'm giving it to you. There isn't any catch. Just drive your truck up here and take it away. I'm not trying to pull anything. I just want... Look, Mr. Adams, if you aren't interested, I'll give it to another junk... antique dealer. Well, that's more like it. Okay, in about an hour? Fine. Goodbye, Mr. Adams. How do you like that? Now you can't even give the stuff away.
What did Mr. Adams say, dear?
I don't know what's gotten into people. Just because you want to give them something for nothing, they immediately get suspicious.
Isn't Mr. Adams coming?
Oh, he's coming, all right, but he didn't sound very happy about it. You'd think he was doing us a big favor.
Isn't he?
Of course not. Some of that stuff is very valuable.
Like Abraham Lincoln's hitching post.
It wasn't Abraham Lincoln's. It was my great-grandfather's. And it's certainly worth a lot more than a busted... Margaret, does the sewing machine mean that much to you?
It isn't a question of what it means, Jim. It's just that, well, we've had it for so long.
But you don't even look at it from one end of the year to the other.
I know, but I suppose I am being rather foolish.
I wouldn't say that. Look, if you really want to keep it...
No, no, you're right. It's just an old sewing machine, and we might just as well get rid of it.
Honey, we'll find a place for it somewhere. In the garage or the basement?
Jim, let's not argue about it. We're getting rid of the sewing machine, and that's that.
Okay, if that's the way you want it.
And we're also getting rid of your grandfather's hitching post.
My great-grandfather's hitching post.
Fine.
Dad!
All the ridiculous things to hang on to.
Dad!
But we're not hanging on to it. I told you.
Bud's calling you.
But I told you. We're in here, Bud.
A hitching post.
Margaret, for the love of Pete, if you want to keep the sewing machine, keep it.
I wouldn't have it as a gift.
Oh, I don't know.
Say, Dad, you better come outside.
Is Mr. Adams here already?
No, but there's a whole crowd of people.
There is?
What do they want?
Everybody wants to buy something.
Bud.
They do, Ma, I'm honest.
Well, we'd better see about this. Let's go, Bud.
Bud, you were told to watch our things, not sell them.
I didn't sell anything, Mom. It was Kathy.
You mean she's already sold something?
Sure. She sold three of those beat-up dolls for 80 cents.
Jim, isn't that awful?
Here's your coat, honey.
Thank you, dear.
But I told you distinctly...
But I didn't do it, Dad. It was Kathy.
That's right. Blame it on a poor, innocent little... Holy jumping catfish. Look at the mob.
Oh, dear. What are the neighbors going to think?
Kathy?
Hi, Daddy. Father, hurry, please.
Kathy, what on earth are you doing?
I'm selling stuff. Isn't it wonderful?
Mother, you've got to stop her. It's awful.
It isn't either awful. It's fun.
Now, just a minute, Kathy. Nobody told you you could sell anything.
I only sold my own stuff.
I know, but...
I told him you'd sell the rest of it.
Kathy!
You see, I didn't have anything to do with it.
We'll never be able to look anyone in the face again.
Why not?
Jim, you've got to do something.
Like what?
The lady over there says she'll pay $2 for Mommy's sewing machine.
She will?
Jim Anderson.
Now, wait a minute, honey. Let's be practical about it.
I don't mind giving my mother's sewing machine away, but selling it for $2.
Margaret, it's going to cost at least $75 to fix up that room, and if we can get part of it this way...
Jim, I think you really would.
Well, why not?
Father!
There's nothing disgraceful about it, is there?
I don't think so.
It's the most disgraceful thing I've ever heard of.
But why? It's our stuff. Why shouldn't we sell it?
Mr. Anderson.
People sell things every day.
Not in their front yards, they don't.
Mr. Anderson, I understand that adorable sewing machine is for sale.
Well...
It doesn't work.
Of course not. That's what makes it so charming. I'll give you $2 for it.
Not so fast, Irene. Don't forget, I saw it first.
Look, I think we'd better...
I'll give you $2.50.
$3.
Collie!
At 40, toodly doodly doodly.
Never mind.
$3.50. Do I hear four? Will somebody make it four?
Kathy.
$4.
$4.50.
$5.
Margaret.
It's my mother's sewing machine, and if I want to bid $5, I'm going to.
But, honey, you...
$5.50. $6.
Margaret, if you'll only...
$6.50.
Well, I'm sorry, folks, but... It looks like this sewing machine isn't for sale.
I guess we took care of that.
But here's a genuine antique hitching post. Would anybody be interested in...
Excuse me, Jim.
What?
Betty, help me carry the sewing machine back to the attic like a good girl.
It'll be a pleasure.
Margaret, you don't have to do that.
You sell your little hitching post and don't bother about us.
But...
We'll get along fine, won't we, Betty?
We sure will.
Well...
How about the high chair, mister?
Hmm? Oh, all right, the high chair. Pull it over here, bud.
Okay, Dad.
Now, here's a high chair you won't see very often. It's all wood and a yard wide. It belongs to that exotic period known as early Grand Rapids. What am I offered?
40 cents.
40 cents? Why, the gravy stains alone are worth that. Will someone start it off with a dollar?
50 cents.
Do I hear a dollar? Will someone make it a dollar?
55 cents.
Mildred, you don't have any use for a high chair. 60 cents.
Well, neither do you. 65.
I'll make it a dollar if you throw in a baby.
Ladies and gentlemen, there's one thing you seem to forget. This high chair was occupied by three of the finest babies in the entire city of Springfield. You aren't buying merely a high chair. You're buying a wealth of happy memories of... Happy hours and,
I'll make it a dollar without the baby.
Bud.
Yes, Dad?
Take the high chair into the house.
But the man said...
Take it inside.
Okay. But he said he'd give a dollar. So how is high chair?
I am sorry, folks, but the high chair isn't for sale either.
This is the screwiest auction I ever went to. Daddy!
What is it, kitten?
I was doing better before you got here.
I know, but we'll do all right. Now, how about this hitching post, folks? It's genuine antique and probably the only one of its kind in existence today.
Mr. Anderson, are you going to sell that bassinet?
Of course. We're going to sell everything, but you wouldn't be interested in that. The whole bottom's coming out.
I'll give you 40 cents.
45.
50.
52.50.
But it isn't worth anything. We only kept it because... Kathy...
Yes, Daddy?
Take the bassinet into the house.
But the man bid 52.50 cents.
I'll make it 53.
Go ahead, Kathy. It isn't for sale.
Gee whiz. All of a sudden, nobody wants to sell anything. I don't know why they came out in the first place.
Look, mister, is anything for sale?
Of course. Now, here's one of the finest hitching posts you'll ever see.
Hitching posts?
It's hand-wrought iron and dates back to the Civil War. Now, what am I offered?
40 cents.
Hold on now. This isn't a laughing matter. It's a piece of genuine Americana. Abraham Lincoln tied his horse to this hitching post, and that alone ought to make it worth... Who'll start it off with $5?
45 cents.
Well, well, well. What seems to be going on here?
Oh, hello, officer. We're just selling a few little things, that's all.
I see. Cleaning out the attic, huh?
That's the idea.
Uh-huh. So far, he's taken half the things back inside.
Well, we did take back a few things.
Say, that's a fine-looking hitching post. Is it for sale?
It's for sale right now. Will someone give me $5?
I will.
You will?
Yeah, that's right. I don't know why, but I've always wanted a hitching post like that out in front of my house.
Okay, you just bought...
$5.40.
I'm sorry, but I just told the officer...
5.5.
Mildred, what on earth are you going to do with a hitching post?
How do I know?
$6.
6.5.
Mildred, really?
Well, I've got just as much right to own a hitching post as you have. $7.
Well, you just said 6.5.
Well, I said 7.
$7.40.
I'll make it 10.
$10?
That's right.
Officer, you just bought yourself a hitching post.
Well, come on, Irene, let's get out of here.
Well, we might as well. I've never seen such partiality.
I suppose hitching posts are too good for the common people.
40 cents for the common people.
Ah! Well, I don't know, but it looks to me like I've driven all your customers away.
Well, that's all right. I guess this is a little out of my line anyway.
No. At least you got rid of the hitching post, didn't you, Mr....
Anderson, James Anderson, Sr.
Thank you. Could I trouble you for your address?
Well, it's 607 Maple, but...
Fine. Now, if you just sign here.
Sign?
If you don't mind.
Oh, you mean a receipt for the hitching post?
No, not exactly. It's more in the nature of official business.
Official?
I don't want you to think this is my idea, Mr. Anderson. I probably feel worse about it than you do.
About what?
I wish I didn't have to do things like this, but after all, I'm only a public servant, and if you just sign here, please.
Officer, will you tell me one thing?
I'll be happy to if I can.
What did I do?
Why, I thought you knew. There's a $50 fine for running a public auction without a license.
Oh, no.
A few days have gone by, and once more we find ourselves in the Anderson Den. It's the same cozy spot, warm and friendly and brimming over with happiness. And people, too. Like this.
6 goes into 30, 5 times. 6 goes into 36, 6 times. 6 goes into...
Kathy, will you please stop that?
I have to learn my gazettas, don't I?
Kathy.
Yes, Daddy?
Learn them quietly.
Yes, Daddy.
Dad.
Let's all do everything quietly.
Dad.
Let's see if we can't behave like an average, normal family full of human beings. Just once.
Dad.
Yes, Bud.
Where's the capital of... Oh.
What?
Never mind, Dad. I'll look it up.
Fine.
Jim, did you see this article?
Which article, honey?
On the other side of the one you were reading the other night. It says, turn that extra space into a sewing room. And you know the way they explain it, it seems like an excellent idea. It's very simple, too. All you have to do is... Jim, aren't you... Betty, what happened to your father?
I don't know, Mother. He was here a second ago.
That's odd. I could have sworn... Jim, where are you, dear? Jim, I'd like you to read this.
Join us again next week when we'll be back with Father Knows Best, starring Robert Young as Jim Anderson, with Roy Bargy and the Maxwell House Orchestra. In our cast were Rhoda Williams as Betty, Gene Vanderpile, Ted Donaldson, Norma Jean Nilsen, Isabel Jewell, Virginia Agnello, Will Wright, and yours truly, Bill Foreman. So until next Thursday, good night and good luck from the makers of Maxwell House, America's favorite brand of coffee. Always good to the last drop. Father Knows Best was transcribed in Hollywood and written by Ed James.
December 6, 1951, Father Knows Best here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Again, a reminder, tomorrow at this time, we will have an hour devoted to the broadcasts of A Date Which Will Live in Infamy, December 7th, 1941. Visit my friend Ted at RadioMemories.com. He supplies programs for you in excellent quality on cassette, CD, or flash drive for your computer, RadioMemories.com. A reminder to you that you can visit my webpage at classicradio.stream. There you can stream our shows on demand. You can learn about building a classic radio collection of your own. You can contact me there. You can find all of our social media links. And most importantly, you can buy me a coffee. The Buy Me a Coffee money goes to help us keep our distribution channels open and help us acquire additional classic radio theater programs to bring to you here on your favorite radio station. Again, that's classicradio.stream. Classicradio.stream. Thank you for tuning in. Please thank this radio station, support their advertisers, and as always, tell your friends the great radio shows are right here at this spot on the dial. Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox on your favorite radio station.